Hello and welcome. I'm joined today by Nandita Das, who has just come out with her book, Manto and I. And as you may be aware, that she made this beautiful film about Sadat Hasan Manto's life called Manto. What made you work on this project, first the film and now the book?
Well, many things. Primarily that I've been very disturbed with everything that's happening around us, and in some strange way actually the relevance of the film has only increased since I started working on it. So I thought, if I have to respond to today, what best than tell Manto's story? Because in 70 years we really haven't learned from our history, from the times that he went through, and also what he grappled with. I mean, Manto grappled with issues of identity, with censorship, with the kind of fear that was there during partition. You know, so I think many of those issues are still all around us.
So, have there been any aspects of Manto's life that you have personally found a little problematic and you could not sort of reconcile with those facets of his writing or his life?
I wouldn't say I can't reconcile. There are contradictions. Like, he was a very angry man. He could be very rude and very, he was very misunderstood often. But I grew up with a father who's very, very Manto-esque, very misunderstood, you know, can be blunt to the point of being rude, deeply sensitive. So there are many contradictions I see, and growing up with a kind of a Manto-esque person also makes me, made me understand Manto better. And doing the film kind of made me understand my father better. So it was quite a personal journey as well for me. And I think artists and art are quite inseparable, at least in my case. I feel in many ways, you know, what I do is also something to do with my inner angst, my own desire to tell those stories. So I thought it might be interesting for people to also see that journey. Being a daughter of an artist, I have enjoyed my father paint, and you know, watching dancers prepare, you know, singers in their rehearsals. I've always enjoyed processes, so I'm hoping that others will enjoy it too.
Right, you said something very interesting about art and the artist being inseparable. You know, we are in very interesting times because a lot of artists have had problematic personal histories, right? How would you respond as a practitioner of art and also coming from a certain background, that should art only be for art's sake, or you know, does it have a larger responsibility?
I think it's a very individual expression. Mm-hmm. I can't tell you what to do and you can't tell me. While we may want to believe that yes, artists, and not just artists, people who are known in various fields, they do have a certain sense of responsibility, because what they do, what they say, how they live, everything impacts a certain perception. People are looking at them as role models. So it would be good. For instance, I support this campaign which is against color bias. A lot of the times people come to me and say, oh, but there are so many big actors and they endorse these fairness creams, why don't you go and tell them? And I always say, it's not my place to tell them. If I value my freedom, I must respect other people's freedom.
Right. What about the cancel culture? For example, there is a problematic artist or a problematic writer when it comes to, you know, endorsement of certain values or certain ethics or some misdemeanors, and then you tend to boycott them, right? What do you have to say to that?
Well, it depends. I mean, today we are living in times where there is trial by social media anyway, right? Also, there's a lot of judgment. Each one of us has opinions, and some of us want to share our dissent more, you know, in a more civil way, in a more democratic way. But for instance, I get trolled all the time. I think we fear freedom too much.
How would Manto have reacted to the times that we are living in?
Well, I think he would have been very, very sad. Considering Manto was a deeply sensitive person, the partition impacted him very personally. And, you know, we also mourn about things that are happening around us, but we still go on with life. That was one period where he couldn't even write. Somebody who was so prolific actually didn't write during partition. And some of his most defining partition stories were written after partition. So I think he would have kind of, in his satirical way, laughed at us, mocked us for not learning anything from our past.
Right. One thing that has vexed a lot of Manto lovers is that despite everything, you know, he chose to leave Bombay and he went to Pakistan. And one anecdote that always comes back to my mind is involving him and Ashok Kumar.
Yeah, Ashok Kumar, Ismat Chughtai, you know, there were Shyam, his very good friend who was also an actor. many writers and, you know, they tried to keep him back. And he was someone who loved Bombay. You know, he would say, "Main chalta phirta Bombay hoon." When people would ask him that, "Aap nahi jayenge Pakistan, itne sare Musalman ja rahe hain." So he would say, "Haan, agar Bombay wahan chala jaye, to ho sakta hai uske piche piche main bhi chal padu." And because he was so sensitive, I think he got very emotional almost about a kind of a perceived sense of betrayal, if not a real betrayal, by a friend who, because he never wore his religion on his sleeve, you know. He wasn't a practicing Muslim. He never went to a mosque. He used to drink, he used to do all the things that were pretty blasphemous by the Islamic laws at least. And here was his closest friend, a Hindu, who kind of said that, yeah, I mean, if there was a riot, I could have even killed you. Because he had also suffered, his family had suffered. There was a history. So what he, I think, was deeply troubled by, not that Shyam, his friend, said that. Not only that film studios were throwing out Muslims at that time, because there was a lot of pressure by the, you know, rightist bodies, as there are now today as well, who were kind of taking it upon themselves to ensure that the Muslims were going. And every time he spoke the truth, every time he wrote something amazing, he was also slapped with a case. And that further threatened and jeopardized his family. And he really loved his wife and daughters. And it was also because he knew that his extended family would take care of his wife and children. When he went to Lahore, and, you know, he just felt that, as it is, I'm doing everything that is jeopardizing my well-being of my family, at least by staying there, they're taken care of. Because he was going to be the person he is. I don't think he was going to stop telling the truth to us.
Three stories that you think that had Manto written them today would have been exactly the same.
Well, 99%, I think, would be exactly the same.